Thank you so much, Amy. And thank you everyone for joining in. What an excellent keynote we've had from Vijay. And to follow up, I could not have asked for better speakers in my panel here today, in the coffee chat we are going to have. We have two very senior leaders from the US and from Bay Area. And between them, they have over half a century worth of experience. What is the most interesting is each of them joined their current CXO positions bang in the middle of the pandemic, right? And that meant that they had a unique set of challenges. They had no time to soak in and absorb. What a great opportunity to learn about these challenges and how they mitigated each of them from these eminent panelists. Rohan, I will come to you to start with. You have been a Bay Area veteran, starting from Stanford and continuing your tech journey across startups and large enterprises. What was it to join DataAxel as Chief Product Officer just a few months back? And also, what did the actual term of the chat we have in terms of leading global technology teams through pandemic times actually mean to you? What were your top challenges and how did you really mitigate them?
Yeah, thanks, Siddhant. Yeah, you're absolutely right. Right, it's been quite the experience. I don't think there's one thing I predicted correctly about what my first 12 months at DataAxel would be like. I joined at the end of February last year, and then the world shut down.
I hope your boss is not around.
It was interesting for us because we're a fairly distributed company in the U.S., but we were, as I joined, one of the charters for me was to open up our global operation, and we were figuring out where to locate it. And this was all thought of pre-pandemic. In reality, I think the pandemic situation accelerated us. And you know, I've been doing this, as you said, for 20 years. And if you go back in time, I've built a team in India, built teams across multiple countries, and now using India again. The reasons have been the same every time we've done that, right? Everyone's doing it to help with a combination of access to talent, transformation and acceleration, and of course, cost efficiency. But the process, and as you pointed out, it's been learned on the fly here. It's been really different. And it's not something that there was a textbook for. And we haven't had to do this. The last pandemic in 1918, there was no globalization of this nature. I think for us, and for me personally, one of the biggest keys in these situations is finding leaders. And you know, if you're opening a single location, it's finding the leader. That person is always the most critical part of that process. And all of a sudden, in these circumstances, you're doing that through virtual meetings from halfway across the world in different time zones, and you're placing a really critical bet for the company. So we've had to actually rethink completely in that process, the process of interviewing and how do you pass judgment on this person who's going to take responsibility for hundreds of people and buckets of revenue? I don't think I've ever in my career until now hired someone at an executive level without sitting down for lunch or dinner a couple of times, right? And you're reading body language, you're getting a feel for how they react to situations on the fly, you're assessing character outside of the formal process. And you know, one thing I've learned is I've had to really trust my instinct a lot, right? You can ask all the questions and go deep. And fortunately, I've been doing this for 20 years. It's a real challenge if you haven't done this several times before to say, okay, this is how I'm going to make that assessment. Yep, this just feels right. And you know, we feel comfortable we hit the ball out of the park on that one. The other challenge then after putting the leader in place has been, you know, as you're building out a team, you're trying to create gestalt in the team, right? Every individual is a part, and your goal as a leader is always to make the whole more than the sum of the parts. But they're all separate from each other. And in our case, they're scattered all over India in their hometowns and not even in Pune where they're building up. And so you've got to build this sense of togetherness and collaboration with a group of people who have never met one another, may not for another 6 or 9 months yet. And you've got to keep them excited about joining a company when there's no tangible company feel that comes with the bustling office that you go into interview and you see that all happening around you. So we've had to put a lot of work into how do we engage people? How do we foster those connections and very actively on a daily basis keep people feeling that they're part of something bigger? So that continuous interaction and making sure that all those conversations are not just functional, hey, you have a task, you have a Jira ticket to follow, but you're part of this family and we're trying to instill company values and principles, right? And create an ethos and culture that fits with your global entity. And you're doing that in a normal circumstance, but again, now everyone's operating blind. So I can't overemphasize, fortunately or unfortunately, how much of this is as simple as, but as difficult as, heavy investment of time and energy, right? This is a recurring theme as I was thinking about what really makes the difference here. It's no coincidence that we're seeing a whole lot of pandemic burnout, but you know, you need your managers, your people to make that effort, to make those one-to-one connections. And it's, you know, outside of normal working hours and 7 p.m. for someone or 7 a.m. for someone else. But that engagement, and where we've done that well, we're seeing the success. And where we have even just, you know, fallen off a couple of percent, we've seen the struggle. And so it's pretty firm to my mind that that's essential to create the payoff that you're looking for. Awesome. I think the one other challenge we've seen in this time is that everybody wants to go global now, right? As a consequence of the pandemic almost. And people have realized that geography is fairly arbitrary. And so the sort of competition you're facing for talent and creating that engagement really sort of makes you double down on that need.
Interesting. So three key things, right? So one is the leaders in terms of hiring them, talent, building the ethos in the talent that you hire, and of course, you know, going global, which increases the competition for talent. I think we'll come back to maybe one or more of these topics, but I'll want to quickly get Ajay in on this, right? So Ajay, you know, you've been part of a large tech companies, you know, not just leading few hundreds of or thousands of people, but tens of thousands of folks spread across globally. And you've been doing this for over two decades. You came into Tech Mahindra. What was it that was very different? Something that, you know, you didn't expect? What was the challenge that you faced, and how did you look at solving that?
Thanks, Siddhant. I joined 3 to 4 months back at Tech Mahindra, and on a lighter note, no honeymoon period at all. It was all action from day one. To get onto the point, let me take a real life example. We all drive cars, right? And when you're driving a car, you're going on a straight road, and whenever there is a turn which is going to come across or a bend, reflexly, your foot is going to get off the gas pedal and you're going to go onto the brakes, slow down, make a smooth turn. Now, if you compare that with the racing car environment, every bend, every curve for the driver is an opportunity, because that's an opportunity for the driver to take over its competitor. Now, if you take this pandemic as a bend, and a very crude analogy, what I believe personally is that individuals as well as organizations have reacted very, very differently to it, because each one of us is unique. We have different appetite, hunger, different kind of risk-taking abilities, different kind of goals for ourselves. So one of the biggest challenge which was there, that in these kind of surreal times, how do you help your customers navigate and be able to service their end clients better? And if you couple with that a concept of saying that all across our associates, how do we build a mindset of a growth mindset which is on a war footing? So I was talking to a CXO of a Fortune company, and he made two very interesting observations. He said that COVID, believe it or not, has been the biggest chief digital officer. And the second comment he made was, he said, I sometimes ponder, and what has stopped us for taking all these big, bold digital initiatives which we're taking right now, why not a year back? And that same mindset, when you talk about a growth mindset on a war footing for us as a team together, it's all about looking at the value zones which you create for our customers. One simple way to look at a value zone is that I'm a service provider, Mr. Customer. How do I fare better with my competitors, my peers in the industry? That's one way to look at value. Another way to look at the value is saying that, Mr. Customer, we have already contracted for certain things. How do I deliver something over and above whatever is contracted in my SOW or PO with you? And that's value definition. There could be another way to look at the value. And that value could be, am I truly helping my customer serve their end clients better? Am I really helping them to be more competitive than their peers in the market? And also, in some cases, if you push the envelope further, if there is a B2B environment, am I helping my customer to help their clients to become more competitive in their market space? So that's a long worded answer to your question, but challenge has been all across helping customers way through these times and get a growth mindset and a war footing for our associates.
Interesting. Very interesting, Ajay, that you spoke about the bend and the racing car mentality. I was just seeing some of the channels with where they drift in to the curve, which is a very different kind of mindset as well. And I'll just pick on that, right? And we now know, and you rightly said that everyone believes that now is the time to invest and grow for the future. And yesterday, Pari's keynote as well spoke about the impending growth war. So this year is going to be the year of the growth war. You spoke about all the right things in terms of overtaking competition. And this growth war is going to be fought on multiple battlefronts, right? It's a battlefront of technology, battlefront of talent. What are those one or two key decisions that you are in the process of making or have made to ensure that you win this war?
Great question, actually. There is a quotation which comes to my mind, which is very close to my heart. It says, yesterday is history, tomorrow is a mystery, today is a gift, and that's why we call it the present. So the pitch approach which we have taken to these market conditions as a team together at Tech Mahindra is that we want to help our customers what they want to be tomorrow, do it today and now. So the tagline is engineer your next dot now. And it stands on three pillars: accelerate, better time to market, invent, do something really, really differentiated in the market space, and transform. If you're doing business in a particular way, can we help you do a business completely transformed in another way? Mm-hmm. And to do that, like you're rightly saying, it's all about investments in people, process, technology, be it hiring leadership, upskilling, cross-skilling, right from our CEO in the organization. We are all top-down saying that, hey, we're going to ensure that we're going to get trained, improve our value, which we generate on all our interfaces with clients. And we have been investing to big time in the technology with our kind of a big leverage, which we have in the telecom industry. How do the 5G is going to play a big role for the enterprises? Can we bring all the best things which can be done to the enterprises leveraging the 5G world? And investments, we're not being shy of saying that we're going to go out in the market and acquire companies. You might have followed us in the last 3-4 months itself. We announced 4 acquisitions, and which were very, very pointed to get very, very niche talent in niche geographies, which can actually be exploded on a global level for a big, big kind of a scale.
Perfect. Perfect, Ajay. Great. So, Rohan, I'll come back to you. And we discussed this, right? I would not let this go. So you have been looked at this talent journey from a very long time, right from your Stanford days, where you actually co-founded Crick Info. That's almost the only digital firm and digital media firm that I know that has survived over 20 years, right? And you've gone through multiple companies, including Yahoo, etc. Yahoo went past. Some of the other companies have thrived. In your mind, as a technology leader in the post-pandemic world, what are the renewed priorities of a tech leader, especially when managing multi-location talent team?
Yeah, that's a great question. Look, I think it is a new era, and accelerated, of course, by COVID. You know, you said multi-location teams at the end there. I think we're going to reach a point at which we're not even thinking of that word location, right? We're just leaders building teams. And actually, it's kind of embarrassing for me to admit right now, but I have plenty of people in my org today whose locations are a complete mystery to me. I don't know where they are. And what I've realized is I don't need to know where they are. It really doesn't matter. I just need to know when people are available. So there's a whole mindset shift that we're going to need in this sort of new leader for this new age who can embrace that, right? And you're going to see that comes out of that, you're going to see a massive embracing of meritocracy, and remote or hybrid work ultimately just forces you in that direction, right? There's an absence of other context, so people will be judged on their results, which is how it should be. But I think the risk of this, which leaders have to manage, is, you know, you don't want your teams to feel in any way less than human, right? We're all people. We want to be seen as such, even if we're measured on results and output. So, you know, I look at it as the biggest thing we need as leaders going forward and in our technology leaders is that ability to have and really drive with empathy and use it constructively, right? I'll give an example, just US-based only, right? Working out of Silicon Valley, as you said, for 20 years with people who've worked here, for better or for worse, there's a somewhat homogenized working culture, right? You expect people to react certain ways in certain situations because that's what their professional experience has guided them to do. And so, you know, you go into a conference room for a meeting in Silicon Valley and I expect at, you know, 4 p.m. when my time is up, the next person is going to open the door, walk in and let me know, hey, you're out, Buster. It's my turn to use the room. As I learned very quickly in the Midwest, people will wait outside and I'll come out 15 minutes late, and then they'll be apologizing to me for having waited for me outside. And this difference in cultures and mindsets and understanding, you need a leader now, because all those people are not together in one place. They don't have that opportunity. They have to be able to really dive in and understand and create that gestalt across the organization. I think the other thing that we've learned actively and really transformed our process, and I referenced interviewing for the leader earlier, but as we're interviewing for talent, engineering talent in particular, right, our whole operating model has changed, right? So as we're spread out over time zones, the extent to which we need to incorporate asynchronous communication in what we're doing is significant, right? We don't necessarily want everyone working at the same time. We want everyone to be comfortable in whatever time zone they are. So we need to make sure that that written communication skill is really strong, right? Whether it's a Jira ticket, a chat message, an email. And this is much more dramatic than it sounds, because it means you have to rethink your hiring profile and process, right? So we're all used to engineers studying on LeetCode, doing 100 questions there, and finally, you know, cracking that interview. And that's how we judge and hire them. Some of our engineering teams are now pointedly including a communication and writing assessment as part of an engineering interview. It's non-standard. We sometimes have candidates look askance, but it has made a difference, because that's the nature of the way we have to operate now. And we're now validating up front, can this person actually fit into this environment and not be misunderstood and not misunderstand as we're talking asynchronously all the time. So it's a real shift and a difference.
Nice. That's a very interesting perspective, Rohan. Thank you. Ajay, I'll just come to the last of the questions. And before I get into the Q&A, we've got one or two very interesting questions. What I want to ask is, you know, we spoke about, you know, how it's going to be a talent supply constrained market. We've got a full day dedicated only to discuss that. How do you see, you know, the difference in how you believe large enterprises should be leveraging tech services firms, or how you are yourself investing in, you know, building capability in diverse locations to help that particular cause?
Sure. What, in my opinion, I believe one of the key elements is all about a very open and transparent communication, which is built on trust along with customers. The once you understand the problem, the stated and the unstated needs, the solution may not lie with either party, but jointly we can figure out a solution. I'll give you an example. There's a customer, a large Fortune customer, industrial manufacturing. Because of geopolitical as well as because of the pandemic, they decided that they had to move $1.5 billion worth of their sourcing, which was in China, to different parts of the world, Mexico, Asian countries, India included. And the solution, how are we going to implement that for them and build a resilient supply chain? So it's all about how do you openly communicate, figure out the unstated needs as well, and figure out a solution. To your question around leveraging the diverse locations, there was a very interesting experiment which was done some time back. And the experiment was that, and I was reading about it. So you have a glass transparent bottle and you place it horizontally on a table and you put a half a dozen flies inside the bottle. And you also put the same number of bees into the bottle. And you should keep the bottom of the bottle facing towards the window where the sunlight is coming, and let the bees and the flies try to figure out as to how they're going to escape from the bottle. And the interesting angle which was there was that while the flies took less than a couple of minutes to figure out a way to go zigzag movement here and there, the bees, with their tendency of having very logical processing, they were only trying to go towards the sunlight. And after half an hour, they were all exhausted onto the floor of the bottle. And that article linked this entire experiment with how organizations have bees and flies in them, where they will have the bees with the brightest talents on the fast track growth, but they'll be all about logic, database decisions, which are there. How the flies will come across with their school of experience, and they'll do a lot of decision on intuition. And the reason I believe that is relevant to the question you asked is, for all of us to figure out the strength of your teams as to which person has got what strength and what situation that person is going to excel in. Once you do that mapping and you bring in all the leverage of your global footprint, things start coming out pretty nicely in terms of serving your customers, help their clients better.
And that's very interesting, Ajay. So what I'll do is maybe I have time for just one final question from the audience, and I'll maybe take this take the lead from where you mentioned and use a relevant question there. And Rohan, you also spoke about hiring the right leader and how it's getting difficult. One of the questions we have is how is it different? So are there different skill sets and capabilities that you need to look for? Like we all know, we have a mental map, we have typical roles defined, our HR is trained to hire certain type of folks in leadership positions. Is it different now? And how is it different? Can you just give a practitioner's perspective? Rohan, maybe you can go first and then Ajay.
Sure. I mean, it is different in my mind. And I think as we look forward, it's even more different. There's a bunch of things. I think one I'd probably highlight is you have to, I think, now look for someone with I'll call it a low operating ego. I'm actually a fan of people having egos. They should have that self-belief and confidence. But the command and control model of leadership, which is often exercised, especially as you go global, that is rapidly become very anachronistic in this new era, right? And there's a quote I've always loved and used, that a leader is measured not by how many followers they have, but by how many leaders they create. And in this model going forward, which is highly decentralized now, again, because of what we've just gone through, that acceleration is happening, your leaders of the future cannot command and control as if they're in a centralized military operation with everyone standing around them. They have to accept that this is decentralized, and they have to be very comfortable and confident in allowing and delegating and building up leaders at every corner of the organization, right? You can't have the traditional every issue or question bubbles up one side of the hierarchy across to the next leader and then down the other side of the hierarchy to get resolved. You need people at all levels to exercise that leadership, which means your leader at the top of the traditional org chart needs to be very comfortable in their skin of saying, not about me. It's not about me making decisions. It's about me pushing that out to others. And, that is the way forward at this point.
Awesome. So Ajay, you want to build on your, how do you find the flies from the bees, if that's what you're going to look at?
I think for me, it's one thing which stands out, especially during these times, is empathy-based leadership. Mm-hmm. And the reason I say that is because it helps us as individuals, while we're interacting with our customers, to step in their shoes and look at the world from their point of view and figure out, like I was articulating earlier, how do you figure out the stated needs obviously come out, but how do you figure out the unstated needs? Once you figure out the unstated needs, the value which you are able to generate could be extremely disruptive. So that's one thing on empathy-based leadership actually stands out for me.
Okay, perfect. Thank you so much, Rohan and Ajay. This has been a great panel. I know this was short, but hopefully the audience has enjoyed it. Back to you, Amy, to continue this interesting confluence.
Just want to make one comment. Next time when we get together, Rohan, I'll definitely strive to get a similar kind of digital background as you, for sure.
Fantastic. Thanks, Ajay. Thanks, Siddhant.
Okay, thank you all.
All right, guys. Take care. All the very best.